Welcome to the WCS Coaches Preview Show. I'm Tate Mathews filling in for Dr. Jeremy Qualls. We've got the head coach of the Page Patriots, Coach Charles Rathbone, with us. Coach, good morning.
Good morning.
Glad you're with us. Big game tonight. 5-2 Patriots coming off the bye week. Got a big game tonight against Giles County. Let's start off with kind of tell us how you spent your bye week. Do you feel like it came at a good time in the season?
Looking back at this game, I kind of wished we'd have played this last week, just because then I know the result. You know, it's hard looking forward to these games. But we just went back to the basics, blocking and tackling, fundamentals, giving them some time off, letting them get their legs back underneath them. And you know, it came at a good time. You know, the guys needed to have that mental downtime, and hopefully we're ready to play tonight.
Well, and you've got an older team, a mature team, an experienced team, I guess. So usually when that happens, you can go back, you can give them a little time off, get their batteries recharged, and you don't have to worry as much about the next game plan. Like you said, you know you've got time to put that in, but this was, I guess, a time to kind of sharpen up on some things that you haven't been able to work as much the previous 7 weeks.
Yeah, we got 12 seniors, but we got 8 of them with a lot of playing time. So, you know, at the first of the year, I was really worried about, are we going to show up? Are we going to show up? Are we going to show up? You know, and I think that's every coach. You know, they want to make sure they show up to play every single game. And I'm kind of past that now. You know, I feel comfortable. We're going to show up and play every night. It's just now a matter, you know, do we put everything together and keep the mistakes at a minimum and make plays?
Last year, I don't know, I'm sure there has been, but last year was one of the worst years, at least under your tenure, you've had as far as injuries. I mean, it just when you thought there can't be another one, there was another one. We've dodged a lot of that this year. Going into the bye week, have you been dinged up much? I guess there's going to be some of those through 7 games, but seems like you're pretty healthy.
Yeah, we lost a kid last week. He didn't play with a concussion. But, you know, you're right. Last year we were just banged up everywhere. You know, we lost our best player. And, you know, our very first scrimmage, about the third play of our very first scrimmage, we lost our best receiver. And, you know, I'm like, oh, gosh, here we go again. But, you know, the good Lord's taken care of us. We haven't really lost anybody, haven't been banged up too much. We've had our, you know, the bumps and bruises like everybody else, but no serious injuries.
Well, let's talk about the Friday night before the bye week. Tullahoma comes to your place. Homecoming. 35-0 victory for the Patriots. It was 35-0 at halftime. I guess a couple of things that I would think, being the head coach, you had to be very proud of your starters and your seniors. That was a game you should have won. You came out, you took care of business, and then I'm guessing second half you got to play a lot of the young pups.
Yeah, we started off pretty slow. You know, it was 7-0 after first quarter, so we put up 28 points. And then we came out to second half and messed up a kickoff return, and, you know, we took a knee or we slid down at our own 1 yard line. So the young guys didn't have much of a chance, to be honest. We put them in bad situation to begin with. But, you know, if going back and look at the film, they played pretty well. Just a few little minor details we got to get worked out with them. But I was proud of the way they came in and competed.
Region win. Let's talk about your team a little bit. It starts with a couple of your seniors, but we're going to start with your quarterback, Michael Magochi. I guess this is his second year as the starter. Mm-hmm. What a great talent he's turned out to be. Good-looking kid. He's a dual-threat guy. I know one of the things you were looking for going into this season was you knew he was going to throw touchdowns, wanted to cut those interceptions down. Right now he's sitting at 1,384 passing yards, 12 touchdowns, 1 interception. That was kind of what you were talking about.
Yeah, and he's done an outstanding job of doing that. You know, last year up through 7 games, he had thrown 3 interceptions. And then he threw something like 6, you know, the last 4 games. So, you know, we spent a lot of time in the offseason looking at film, and he worked on that. He watched his mistakes, and he's done a great job taking care of the ball. And, you know, he's getting people lined up. You know, he's making the right reads. He's, you know, if he's in trouble, he's going to get rid of the ball. He's not going to throw it to somebody else's hands or try to force the play, you know, to kind of live and play another day. And he's done a great job. You know, he's had some guys hanging on him. He'll dump it off to the check down, and then Michael Roberts is turning it into a big play. So he's done a phenomenal job this year.
Yeah, I think that would be one of the things that is kind of hard to coach with a guy like him. He's a guy who can make plays, both with his arms and his legs. Sometimes, though, that's the right thing to do. You know, he, as a competitor, he wants to make a play when the right thing to do is go through the progression, like you said, hit the check down, and a little 5-yard swing pass turns into a big gain. Does that come with age? Does that come with reps?
Yeah, I think especially with him, because he'd always been a defensive player, a linebacker. He's a defensive mentality at heart. You know, he won't slide, although he's got better at that this year. He'll try to lower his head and run over somebody. So he never played quarterback until his sophomore year, and we just lucked up and saw him throwing on the field after practice one day. So I think with him, it's limitless how much he could grow at quarterback, and I think somebody's going to get a very good player. But you know, you're right. It's the maturity of that position.
Michael Roberts, your running back. I don't know if you call it a tailback in your offense. We'll call it a running back. But if there's a better two-way player around, I don't know who it is. What a great senior year he's having. 528 rushing yards, 8 touchdowns, 326 receiving yards. 337 receiving yards, 3 touchdowns. You go over on the defensive side, I guess we got to call him the leader of your defense, 62 tackles. He's literally, if he's out there, there's a good chance he's going to make a play.
Yeah, he's the best player, maybe the best player I've ever coached. And, you know, his what his real strength is, he's just an extremely smart football player. He knows how to take on a block. He knows how to keep an arm free. He knows when to dive inside. And I don't like when he does that, but when he does it, he makes plays. And he has a different burst. He's not your 4-4 guy, your 4-5 guy, but when he needs to get that extra burst, he'll get it and he'll run a guy down. And he's just he's an extremely smart and extremely talented football player.
Yeah, you hear about it. There's track speed and then there's on-the-field game speed. And as a coach, you want the guy who's got that other gear on the football field. The fast 40 time's nice, but you'll take a guy like him every time.
Yeah, if that 4-4 slows down to a 4-8 at contact, then, you know, he's no better than that 4-6 that goes to a 4-4 at contact. So, and Roberts is that guy that picks up that speed and runs through his tackles and then runs through people that are trying to tackle him. He's a special player.
All right, before we get to the Giles County game, we start off, the season's 5-2, start off with a big win at home against Fairview. A game that you all really, I know you had talked about it in your seniors, and a game you had circled from the year before. That was a big win. Came out, you know, you never know in a game like that.
Right.
First game, it's a cross-county rival. You never know how you can be. I thought you came out firing on all cylinders. That was a great way to start off the season.
Yeah, and that's probably the best we played as a group so far. And we've been pretty consistent, to be honest with you. But you're right, on that game we were making plays, making throws, running, tackling, you know, we just executed, you know, exactly the way we'd hoped we would have, and we played really well against Fairview.
You've got 2 losses by, I guess, a combined 2 points.
Right.
Both of them in overtime. One of them was at the end of the game.
Yeah, one of them was 7 seconds to go in the game.
7 seconds to go a game against Lipscomb Academy.
Right.
Overtime against BGA. Go for 2 on both of them. I like it. You know, I think that shows confidence in your team and your seniors. But kind of talk about, come up a little bit short on both of them. One of them. We're not in the excuse-making business, but I'm not quite sure that was a – y'all got the fair end of the call. But, hey, it matters where you finish. But talk a little bit about that. I would think that when you're talking to your team, there's got to be some positives that have come out of that. But kind of how have you dealt with those 2 just heartbreaking losses?
Well, here's what I told the team afterwards. And you know, I tell them that the blame could be put on me because I'm the one that makes that decision. But I also tell them that the moment that I stop believing that they're going to make that play, the moment I stop believing that we're going to execute and win the game, then that's when I'll step down and won't be their head coach. Because you got to believe in your players. And I believe in this team and every team I've ever coached, but I believe in this team that they're going to make the play, that they're going to step up. And whoever, it don't have to be Magochi, it don't have to be Roberts, that we're going to make the stop at the end of the game or we're going to make the play at the end of the game to score. And, you know, when you got the ball on the 3-yard line and you got an offense that I feel is pretty good, you know, why not take that shot?
Yeah, and you know that come the time it comes again, they already know. They're not going to have a doubt. They know the belief in them. And I got to think that the experience of being in those situations, it's going to pay off down the road. You never know. Might happen tonight. Might happen down the road in the playoffs. But you've been in those situations, and I just think there's a lot of positives that can come out of it.
Well, you know, last year at Giles County, we went for 2 to win it in overtime, and we won it. So, you know, there's always – it's a 50-50 shot, but, you know, I mean, when you got guys that you believe in and you see the work they put into in the weight room and all that stuff, you know, you gotta think that if we roll out one of our players out that he's going to get in, or if we give it the ball to Michael or Dylan Myers or whoever, you know, they're going to get in. And I have faith in them, and if I had those calls to do over again, I'd make them in a heartbeat.
On the receiving end, we mentioned, obviously, Michael Roberts is having a fine year receiving the ball as well. Connor Morse doing a good job for you. Trevor Johnson, Andrew Mettler, Meckler, Will Pierce. You got a lot of guys, and in an offense where you're spreading out, you got a lot of guys and a lot of options for Michael. Again, I think coming postseason time, I think that's got to be something that you feel really good about.
Yeah, I do. And Michael doesn't seem to lean on one of those guys more than the other. He spreads the ball around really well. He takes his read, and he throws the ball into his read. And you know, we talk to him a lot about throwing to a spot. Don't throw out the receiver, throw to a spot. And all those guys are in the spot they're supposed to be at. And so I'm very proud of that group for stepping up. And we knew we had some talent there, but they really stepped up far beyond what the expectations were.
So 7 games in, what do you know about your team? Okay, what are some of the things that you feel really good about? I'm confident in this. I know these are the things that we're good at. And what are a few of the things in these next few games going into the playoff run that you feel like you all need to shore up?
Well, you know, I feel like we're a physical team, especially defensively. We show up and we play every single week defensively. You know, nobody, you know, no matter how big they are, they're, you know, we're going to get in there and play and we're going to hit. I also feel like, you know, we're explosive. We can score from anywhere on the field. The one thing that I want to make sure that we're better at is mentally. We got to execute those plays. We got to make sure that we're, you know, our linemen are pulling and getting where they're supposed to be, making those blocks, staying with your blocks, and finishing plays. We got to finish plays. And we've done that for the most part, but, you know, you never want to get in a habit where you hit somebody and they break a tackle or we're not all getting to the ball and gang tackling. You know, it's very important for our defense to gang tackle, and that's what we're going to stay on top of them about.
All right, real quick, let's talk about tonight, Giles County. This is kind of a little bit of a – I know this is a game. I know you're confident, but I don't want to use the word trap game, but they hadn't won a game. There was a coaching change, which I know you and I can't ever remember seeing anything like that around here. And they get a big win against Spring Hill last night. Giles County is always talented, but, again, can't have a lot of confidence in themselves right now. I would think if you can get on them early tonight, it'll be good for the Patriots.
Well, that's our hope. Our biggest worry, they're very athletic, you know, and I think their problem is they really haven't played as a team. And then last week at Spring Hill, they got some confidence. They played as a team, but we're kind of going into this blindfolded. A new coach, he's had 2 weeks to prepare for us. We don't know what they're going to put in. We don't know if they're going to go back to run the Wildcat. Last week, Spring Hill, they ran the Wildcat every single play. They rushed for 500 and something yards, threw the ball twice. You know, you got to think they're going to have some sort of something off of that, you know, prepare for us. So, you know, it's tough when you don't really know what to prepare for.
Coach, we're going to go to a break. When we come back, you can kind of tell us what we can expect from them offensively, defensively, some schemes like that, players to watch. When we come back, we'll be with Coach Charles Rathbone, head football coach of the Page Fighting Patriots.
What the? What? I should have thrown you away? Okay, I'm sorry.
Welcome back to the WCS Sports Connection Coaches Preview Show. Tate Mathews filling in for Dr. Jeremy Qualls, Coach Rathbone, head football coach of the Page Fighting Patriots. Coach, before we get back to Giles County, you wear two hats, or a lot of hats at Page. You're also the athletic director at the school, have been for a few years now. Real quickly, football's not the only exciting thing going on over off Arno Road right now. Let's start with girls soccer. Coach Clapp always does a great job. Another fine year for the Lady Patriots.
Yeah, on Thursday night, tonight, they'll line up at 6 o'clock and play CPA for the district championship. CPA is the number one ranked team in the state. And, of course, our soccer teams are always very good. So they went down to a Chattanooga tournament. They beat CAC, who was number one at the time, and won that tournament. So now they're getting a chance to play the number one team with a chance to win the district championship.
Yep, and Coach Qualls and I talked about it earlier in the week. We've got a lot of great soccer teams here. We've got a lot of great soccer coaches. I'm not sure that Coach Clapp doesn't do as good of a job with what he's got, both boys and girls, as anybody around. And that CPA Page, both boys and girls, that's become a heck of a rivalry in soccer.
That's a battle for sure. It's fun to watch.
Volleyball. Coach Hess, the Lady Patriots in sub-state, I guess that's where we are right now, got a good chance to go back to the state tournament again. Is that correct?
Yeah, but Tuesday night they won a district championship. I think Amber Jones was tournament MVP. playing very well. He's got them playing very hard, playing very well. And of course, volleyball, you know, we got 5-6 state championships, and hopefully going to bring another one home this year.
Yep, it's going to be exciting. I would think they got to be one of the favorites in AAA. Cross country, Colin Lamb, got to be the favorite going into the state tournament.
Yeah, I'll tell you what, that kid's running all the time. You know, we're out of football practice, and he'll just go running by, and he makes me tired. He runs so much, but he's incredible. And the whole team's done really well. I don't know exactly where they placed in the region. I know it was in the top two, but he's definitely got a shot at winning it.
I tell you another thing that has been fun to watch. I haven't been able to beat one yet, and I want to get there before the year's out. Dr. Shane Pantall comes over. He's your principal this year. School spirit, I guess, is one of the things he really wanted to ramp up there. The pep rallies. And yeah. Y'all are taking pep rallies to a whole another level over there. Again, the football team's having great success, so that goes hand in hand with it. But your student support's been great. The pep rallies have been great. There's just a real good vibe in the halls right now.
Yeah, Shane's he's a very supportive, athletic-minded principal. And, you know, he does a great job. He comes up with all these ideas, and we're all working together to execute these ideas. And, you know, he's been fun to work for so far.
Let's get back to the game tonight. For those that the Patriot fans that are coming or the ones that are just interested, kind of tell us, again, Giles County, I think everybody knows you can expect an athletic team. There's right. going to be speed, and they're going to have athletes, okay? Kind of tell us what, and maybe it's changed since the coaching changed 2 weeks ago, but offensively, what can we expect to see out of the Bobcats, and what are some of the things that you all need to make sure, hey, we've got to make sure we take this away from them to be successful?
Well, they're very physical up front. They average about 230 to 250 across the front. So their line play is very good, but they'll line up from what we've seen. Their best running back, number 24, I think it is, Tucker, he'll be their quarterback, and they'll run the zone read. So they'll take the other quarterback or the other running back, he'll cross, he'll read that backside in, they'll just kind of pound it up inside. And you know, last week they kept the ball away from Spring Hill. I think they had it something like 28 minutes, 30 minutes, something like that. It was a long time that they kept them away. But they just pound the ball, and he's tough to bring down. He's about 5'10", 215 pounds, and very fast, a very physical running back. Probably the best running back we've seen this year other than what I feel, Michael Roberts. I feel like he's the best one. When they do bring in the quarterback, he'll throw a lot of screens, try to get the ball out into the receiver's hands. But really, it's just a ball control offense. You know, they'll pack everything inside, bring in two tight ends, and put them both at a wing on the same side to overload you. And we just got to make sure we line up right, take on blocks, get rid of blocks, and our linebackers fill the holes and wrap up and tackle and gang tackle this kid.
And I would think going into against you all, the game plan's got to be to kind of try to shorten the game a little bit, keep the ball away from you. And when you're pounding it like that and then throwing the screens, you all are aggressive on both sides of the ball, I guess hoping for a seam, an over pursuit, something like that, and catch you where you're not out of position and maybe take it.
Yeah, if you give him a crease, he's going to take it to the house. And that's what we got to make sure that we're filling at the right places and taking on the right gaps and responsibilities. Don't get reached if you're in a three. Things like that is really what we worked on. But I tell you what, it's gonna be interesting to see what kind of little gadgets they throw in for us.
Yeah, defensively, lining up against you all, obviously you're gonna have to take away something. Okay, so you're successful running the ball, you're successful passing the ball. Kind of tell us what defensive formation, do you expect to see them in tonight? And then do you think they'll try to take away the run, take away the pass first? They're gonna have to try to take away something. What do you expect to see out of them?
Well, they run a 3-4. Some people call it the old 5-2. You know, it depends on, I guess, what generation you grew up in. But I think they're going to load the box to try to take away the run and maybe man us up like Spring Hill did on the outside and think they got better athletes than we have. So if they do that, then obviously the screen game's going to be open and getting it in Michael Roberts, Dylan Myers' hands. But it'll be interesting to see if they can cover the guys like Connor Morris and Trevor and Andrew. They can run pretty well too, so it'll be a fun matchup.
For those that are watching, kind of explain to them. I always like things like this, but you mentioned a 3-4. You know, when we're watching TV or playing Madden or whatever it is, you know, you think three down linemen, four linebackers, but really it's a 5-2. What you're saying is explain to them, it's a five-man front, a 50 front. How you want to go about doing it, kind of one of the things that's kind of in style right now is it's still a five-man front, but you're walking those two outside linebackers up. You got the three linemen, and now you have a five-man front, 50 front, kind of what you're talking about. Now you're back to a 5-2.
Right, man. And usually with a 3-4, they'll keep those they call them defensive ends, but they'll keep them somewhere on the tackle, either inside shoulder, outside shoulder. And in a true 5-2, you'll see sometimes they'll eagle down and try to get that outside linebacker or defensive end on the outside shoulder. You know, they just play games, but it's all the same thing when you really look at it. I feel like, you know, we're going to try to simplify things. So if you start saying, well, they're in a 5-2, well, how do you tell? Well, they're in a 3-4. You know, keep it simple for the kids and let them block on their techniques and go from there.
That's right. And I'm guessing, you know, sometimes it's hard, especially at a 4A school until you get to the 6A schools. Sometimes it's hard to find linemen. I know they've got a big offensive line, but it allows you to get some more speed out on the field, I guess, a couple more athletes. But also, sometimes you don't have five down linemen to run a 15, so you put in four linebackers and go from there.
Right, it allows you to get some smaller guys on the edge, and they still got to be physical, but it definitely, instead of having, you know, four or five 250-pound players, and then you need their replacements if they get hurt, Now you can play with three or four or five of them and then rotate them in. And I guess that's the advantage. You know, I know for a long time at Ravenwood, when Rector was at Ravenwood, they ran the 3-3, and I think that's why they did it up there and very successful at it. So, we were lucky enough. We like the four-man front. We feel like we get more in the box and make it a little bit easier responsibility on our D linemen by playing that front. But to each his own, I guess.
Kicking game. Especially when you get into the postseason, it's going to be – there's three parts of the game, offense, defense, kicking game. I would think that going into just about every game, you all have to feel like you're at least even or have a leg up. Let's start with your kicker. I messed it up at game day, so I don't want to do it again. Talk to us about your place kicker.
Brent Samaglia.
Samaglia, that's right.
You know, he committed to Southern Miss. But, you know, that's an area the last couple of weeks I've been kind of disappointed in. You know, against BGA, we had a field goal blocked, we had a punt blocked, and missed another field goal, and those things we just can't do. We got to be very disciplined and execute all of our special teams, and we haven't done it the last two games, and it cost us a game. So I'm a little worried about that, but you know, we've worked on that quite a bit the last 2 weeks, and hopefully, Brent will get a little bit healthier. You know, he was kind of banged up a little bit, but. Hopefully he'll get a little bit healthier and we'll get back to executing the way we did early on in the season.
The other part of it that I think sometimes gets lost is when he is healthy, he can kick it to the end zone. And what that does is that takes away – in high school football, that takes away the threat of a kickoff return for a touchdown. Also, it makes them – you know they're going to have to go 80 yards. That's a big deal, you know, especially when you got guys playing both ways. It kind of helps you with who you got to put on the kickoff coverage team too. So again, when he's healthy and can kick that thing to the end zone, that's a heck of a weapon.
Yeah, and we talked about their athletes. You know, you're pretty much taking for at least that one play, the athletes out of it because they're getting the ball at the 20. They're not going to have a chance to return one on you. And really, as a coach, you worry about those special teams that they can score on. Well, he negates that. You don't have to ever worry about that.
Going to Southern Miss, that's a heck of a – it's nice to have that off his plate and know where he's going. But, again, we've had a lot of players now coming out of this sports conference going on to Division I football. Yeah. He's another one. I just think that's a really neat deal. It brings exposure to the whole team. A lot of positives that come out of that.
Yeah, and he's worked very hard. I've never seen a kicker work as hard as he does. He's up here on Sundays for a couple hours kicking. And he loves his craft, but hopefully – That's a theme of Williamson County. You know, we're starting to get these athletes and signing big-time schools, and you know, it makes you just be proud to be a part of this athletic conference and to represent, you know, all of Williamson County, not just your school.
Fall break, so we got the game tonight. We're expecting a win by the Patriots tonight. No, you're not going to count it before you get it, but kind of talk about you just came off the bye week, and now you're going to fall break. You don't have school tomorrow and the Monday and Tuesday. How will you handle next week going into the game?
Well, I've told the seniors, you know, if we show up and take care of business and win, I'm gonna give them Friday and Monday off, and then we'll just we'll do all of our game planning, maybe spend an extra 30 minutes or so on Tuesday and install and rep it on Tuesday so that's the plan. Again, I'm a big believer in letting these kids be teenagers, letting them have some time for their families. And you know, I know parents have got some vacation scheduled, and, you know, who am I to take that away from them? And we'll have them prepared next week for White House, and we'll just have to do it a little more creative way.
White House, another very quality program. Won a lot of games in the mid-state. Coach Porter, he's been the head coach there since close to when you and I were born. So he does a great job, well-respected, another quality program. And then I guess we got the Marshall County game coming up in a few weeks. I think that one's going to be a fun one. Do you know right now, are we in? Depending on what happens tonight, are we definitely in the playoffs? What do we need to do to make sure we're in the playoffs? And I know the goal is to win every game.
Yeah.
And then the following games after that.
We are in the playoffs. If we beat Giles County tonight, we'll host a first-round playoff game for the first time in 12, 13 years. And then we'll line up to play Marshall County for the district championship here on the 30th.
I think that's going to be a fun one the night before Halloween. Maybe there'll be some kind of theme. Coach Pantol, have everybody, or Dr. Pantol, have everybody fired up. Well, man, good luck tonight. It's been an exciting season. I think this is a special team. I hope we can stay healthy, and I think we will. I think we'll be successful tonight, and I'm looking forward to seeing you all get ready for your playoff run.
Thank you. We're excited. We'll be okay, I believe.
It's been the WCS Coaches Preview Show. Thank you for watching. Coach Qualls will be back next week. Get out and support one of our teams tonight.
Running on his feet. He's down out of bounds at about the 11-yard line.
Rossi.
What a game by the young fella keeping
He's
it in bounds.
In.
Oh. There's Percy across the middle.
Nice catch. Nice run by Percy. Not going down as you talked
about. Wow.
My God.
Round the handoff. Oh. Jefferson in space.
He's going to make some people miss right
here.
He's
going to get a block.
Man alive.
Patera got caught. There's
that
another block.
Another block.
Jefferson trying to turn the corner. And that, my friends, is going to make a 90-yard touchdown. Dotson style. Well, no, he's going.
How is
he's still going.
Down.
He's still in.
Oh, my God.
Tyrell Dotson.